Have you seen? He said it's a compound fertilizer. If you look at this one and you look at this one, they are all D compound, but it depends on where the sources or the manufacturer of that particular fertilizer. If you go to Omnia, you will find a D compound which looks almost white, cream to white, yes. Grayish like. Okay, and the grains are actually relatively bigger than what you can see here. If you go to Greenbelt, you find that their fertilizer also is different. You go to Nitrogen Chemicals, their fertilizer decompound is again different. Okay, so if you find fertilizer on the market different from what you have seen here, don't say, what kind of fertilizer is this? But it's important for you to understand the source of that particular fertilizer. Okay, and I appreciate whether it's D or not. At times, people, they tend to fake the type of fertilizer. They'll just package things which look like this. And they'll be selling in three packs and saying, this is fertilizer, come and buy. So that's why I have brought this type of these types of fertilizers, so that you appreciate that we have different types of fertilizers depending on the source. If you are going to get fertilizer from China, it will also look different. The grain size also will look different, but it will also perform the same function. But at times, what they claim is on the label here might not be true. So if you are going to have the chance to work for a particular fertilizer company, you should also try to make sure that what you claim this fertilizer contains is exactly what is in this pack. Okay, so others, they would say, we have 46% nitrogen in urea, but in most cases you find that it's less. So if you are suspecting that you applied fertilizer and you followed these other agronomical practices, but again your crop is not responding favorably, it's important to take the fertilizer for testing. Go to Zabs, you can also bring the fertilizer here, or you can take it to Zari. Test, see whether what you applied was decompound and in what quantities. Okay, and also depending on the region where you are, if you are in northern province where you receive a lot of rains, how much fertilizer should you apply? It's important for you to follow those particular recommendations. If you come to Lusaka, again you have to understand the soils, the rainfall pattern, and the type of the fertilizer which you need to apply. You go to southern province, similarly, you follow the same pattern. Okay? Others, they will just say blanket recommendations like this. But fertilizer may not work depending on the type of the soils, the rainfall pattern in the particular area where you are. So, as the people who are scientists, either soil scientists, or agronomists, or animal scientists, definitely it's important for you to understand. If people are going to work in extension, you should be well versed with the type of fertilizer which is on the market and its function, and also the rainfall distribution. Are you in the high rainfall area, medium or low rainfall area? What type of soils do you have, and what can you do to that such kind of soils in case you have a problem where the farmers are complaining? Because the farmers might not complain to where they bought fertilizer. They will come to you as an extension worker or an extension officer. My crop is not doing well. So you start now asking, have you added this? What type of soils? Definitely you can visit there, go and check, take the soil samples, and then you can advise appropriate. Okay? So, have you all seen the D? Yeah?
Yeah.
We also have Super D, which is marketed by Omni, I think. It might also look different. So one thing that you need to understand is that the compound D comes in different styles, different packages, and with different colors, yes? In terms of the grains. If you compare this one, it's different. You see what I mean? It's very, very, very different. This one, I don't know. I don't know the source of this one. This is DS. Okay. Exactly. I don't know whether I see super deep. I don't know.
So, sir, what makes it super deep?
What makes it super deep? Can somebody answer that question? Yeah, you have heard his answer. He's saying maybe they have branded other things there. That's what makes it super. Others, can you contribute? Maybe it's organic. Can organic be super deep? Yeah, somebody saying maybe it's the name which can attract the customer. But the... Hello?
Maybe it's the one they use to write soap.
What? This one, I think it's just the name. Eh? This one, for me, can also, can be super deep. This one from Zambian Petrizer. You have N, you have P there, you have K, and you also have sulfur, and you have zinc. But for super D, in most cases, for sulfur, they will say 6%. For zinc, they are going to say 0.01%, and they will call it super D. Other brands, I might not know. And you also find Petrizer in this ratio, where you have here 20, there 10, there 20, depending on where you are. If you went to Zimbabwe, you are not going to get 10, 20, 10. If you went to Malawi, you are not going to get 10, 20, 10. How do they come up with this kind of Petrizer formulations? It is dependent on the source. Okay, the inherent soil fertility of that particular country, whether it's acidic or alkaline. Okay, so don't just say, ours is 10, 20, 10. This is for Zambia, Zambian case. 10, 20, 10. You get the point?
Maybe just a comment. Like Zimbabwe, I saw what they call D company from Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. It was the NPK was 5, 10, 5. Mm-hmm. So like you're saying, that fertilizer, it meets the standards there.
Yes.
But according to our standards, it's 10, 20, 10 in terms of the chemical composition in the D compound.
Yeah. So you have heard,
This is where our farmers are cheated, because a businessman will just come and he say, I'm selling fertilizer.
Mm. You see, you can also become a smuggler based on the weaknesses of the system, right? And also if you have realized that our borders are very, very weak, all us. And people work under phytosanitary and quarantine unit, and the ZAPs in those areas are not doing their jobs. And at the same time, we have the inspectors in the borders. You know that?
Yes.
Where the people, these guys, they inspect the what? The plants. They inspect if you claim you have the media, they have to inspect that kind of media. If they have a quarrel with it, definitely they will arrest you and say, we are going to quarantine this until we verify what you claim. It's a right thing, okay? So if you become an inspector under Zari, make sure that you understand what is coming inside. If somebody is importing, you know the problem which is there is that when you are getting the importation permit, you go to Murungushi. The officer there is going to issue, oh, this guy is importing so. Is to allow you travel and also import those commodities into the country. But at the border, you have to declare. Not so. But imagine a situation where you are there as an inspector, and it happens that you don't even understand the kind of fertilizer which is coming in. Okay? It becomes so difficult. So it's very, very important to know the standards which you have in Zambia and in the neighboring countries. Then you can advise the government appropriately. Don't say, ah, no, the government is not there. You are the government yourself.
But sir, the issue gentleman brought out...
It's about smuggling.
Smuggling.
About smuggling, yes. It's difficult to curb that. If you cannot report, if you are suspecting, you have to report that. I think what we are... I'm suspecting somebody smuggled. But it's a syndicate usually, yeah? Where you find that their cartels have been made and it becomes so difficult for you to... And usually your people who are in agriculture in big positions are the ones who are in Falkland to do the smuggling. So a mayor person, when he comes to report to you, it becomes so difficult. You come to report to Minister of Agriculture instead of going to maybe SCCA or going to a different wing. They'll just say, no. My friend, we imported that one. Then you are shattered. So it's incumbent upon you to take just an individual initiative and responsibility.
And your farmers are always advised to get seed and petrol from registered suppliers,
but in most cases they look what they
maybe a comment from the field experience. Yeah, I want to give an example of Eastern Province, for example. Just when you cross the Rongo River, the bridge, there's a route that goes into Mozambique. That route is not mine. There's no customs, there's no ZRS, there's no anyone. So even when you want to go there, you can load a big truck, the interlink truck, 50 metric tons. It will go into Mozambique and come back. And then up to Chama, I think there are only three degraded borders. Shanida, Mwami border, and the one in so when you talk about this problem, these things are there, and it's not that maybe the system people are weak. But it's also because maybe we don't have a natural barrier to help us, so people move at will.
So you see those weaknesses. I think you can go ahead and advise the government on what needs to be done. And then I have the area here. Okay. You can look at urea there. It looks like sugar. Those who are the lovers of sugar, you can make zig. Okay. And this urea, usually it's at the end of 46%. Excuse me. It has... the end of 46%. Excuse me, let's finish this last then we go ahead. It has the end of 46. If you are using ammonium nitrate as a top dressing fertilizer, how much end do you expect there? Huh? 42. Ammonium, if you are using ammonium nitrate as a top dressing fertilizer, how much N do you expect from there? 40? 36%?
36.
Huh?
46.
Huh? What? 46 in ammonium nitrate?
No.
Ammonium nitrate is less. Okay? So it's important for you to know that besides urea, we have other top dressing fertilizers. Okay? Yeah. So I have another one. Where is it? The other one. I have this one, potassium chloride, which looks also like sugar or like Cremona. Those who are lovers of Cremona, here is another type of
potassium chloride.
Okay, potassium chloride. We use mostly potassium chloride in tomato just before flowering. Okay. And it is used as a top dressing fertilizer, but not in field crops, usually in tomato. Okay. And we have this one. We have not to potash. You can check on the grains and the gara. No. What of potash? Okay. So when you look at potash, that one contains. What does it contain? Potassium. It contains potassium alone, but we use that one in most cases as base fertilizer. More to potassium. Usually, base for yes. Usually in the most feed crops. Okay. And there is one fertilizer which I don't have here, marketed by again on the KP Max. It is also high in phosphorus and used as base, but it's in liquid form. You do the drenching. Okay?
Which one said which crop? Food crop or the food crop?
Which one? This one you can use it in the food crops. Potassium chloride usually is used in the food crop like tomato before flowering. It's top dressing. No, it's better. Yeah, where I want to increase the amount of phosphorus in the soil. And this one looks like the copper chloride. Okay, so if you know copper chloride, if I brought copper chloride and this one, definitely it will confuse you. Okay, you say this is copper chloride, but you see. 40 feet, all 40 feet or hyper feet. Okay, yeah, it contains in most cases. Sorry. You use in different types of crops. Okay, and the first thing that you need to do is to rinse. Okay, this one you can use it as top dressing as well as basil, and you can also use it as a foliar fertilizer, meaning you are going to spray, dilute it and spray foliar after getting the roots. Okay, this is what we call polyfeed, meaning it has deep micro and macro nutrients. Okay, yeah, then there are different types of crops.
What are the drain?
Copper, iron, manganese.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Molybdenum and
magnesium. No, this one you can use through fertigation. You know fertigation?
Yes. Oh. I mean magnesium.
You apply. You dilute the same this hyperfeed in a container. That container should be connected to the drip lines, and you allow the water to run or to irrigate the crop per station. That is fertigation, meaning you are adding in water. Foliar, you use the same knapsack sprayers, but in most cases, like what he's saying, it bends his crop. You should monitor the time of application, okay, and the concentration is very important. When you spray when it's too hot and the concentrations are very high, you expect the scorching to come. So the best way, if you experience that kind of a thing, is to wash down the fertilizer, because this is high in soil. Okay, you apply a lot of water so that the plant can take a lot of water in there, and you wash some. You wash them down. Others are going to move rapidly, or some will get leached. If it is in the drip line, again it becomes a bit difficult. Okay, it means you have to go to the source where you have a tank and add extra. And agitate. This what I mean? Or what you can do, remove the drip lines away from the bed, if they are on the bed. Put them in shams and flush out. Go and open the other end. Flush out the open petrizer. But in most cases, the petrizers which we use for fertigation is very expensive. So in most cases, it is used in high-value horticultural crops. Okay? So before you apply, make sure that you have good consultation and you understand what you are applying. Okay? Then at times, not at times, actually always, when you are applying the polyphenol, all you need to do is, it should be in fine mist, not wetting per se. If you wet your crop, it will mean that it will bend there, it will scorch there. Okay? So droplets on the leaf. For this one, I've said, for hyperfeed, usually it is for high value agricultural crops. For somebody to enter into high value agricultural crops means it's not a poor resource farmer. You have moved an inch away from that. Because it's expensive and it requires that consistency. Okay? Okay? Or if you want, if you have that precision, a pinch. First water your field, then come with your fertilizer and just a pinch, you find that you just dissolve within seconds. Okay? Yeah. But in water, you lose literally nothing. Yeah? Then can I have seeds, Mr. Sakala? So, do you know the seed which we planted last time? Can somebody shout? Not 26.
No.
Lion.
Lion.
You planted the lion. Okay, now. The other seed from me.
That's the lion.
Okay, we planted this one. Okay. Huh? You have seen this one? This is the one which we planted. Others are saying lion. I appreciate very much. Typical 620, 27. For lion is for grandfathers and mothers who cannot read and write. It is easier to identify a lion. I just say, I want that lion. See, it is for you, a son. Okay? Then, and it's important for you to know that this is a medium. And it has to be planted depending on the agroecological. The other one which we are likely to plant is this one. You see this one? You see the one? 60? Yeah? 621, eh? Yeah, and this one again is a medium maturing variety. Also, it falls. Is it a lion or a lion? So you see, this is how it will confuse you. Okay? So, because this is medium, that's why the lion comes in. That one is medium. So if you just come and say, no, I want lion, they will give you, they will know it's a medium. It's a medium maturing variety this person is looking for. Okay? Yeah. Now, when you go to Zamsi, you are not going to find the, like SC, you find a different MM60Y. Do we have MM6 watt under Zamsi? Let's go from the field. MM602.
At value.
Okay. Then when you go to Pana, also you are going to find something like Pan, something, something. You go to Monsanto, you are going to find a dog of seed, 831. Okay? Then when you go to Kagyu, you also are going to find the Kagyu seat. When you go to MRI, also you are going to get MRI 6 something, something, something. So depending on the seed which you are looking for, whether it's for your snack, or it's for mirimi, or for livestock and whatever, you can choose appropriate. Whether it's early maturing, a medium, or late maturing. So you have the variety of you have the variety of companies where you can go and search for the type of seed which you are looking for. Yeah? Mm. No, different companies, they have different ways of coming up with the series. Eh? Like for Zamseed, I know, depending on the series, which one came earlier? They will say this one maybe is early, this one is medium, this one is it? Late. Okay? You go to the one, to the varieties from GAT, you find GV111, it was bred there. Okay? Mount Makuru, what? So, depending on the company, they will have a different system of coding. So, it's important to understand this. What does this mean? Okay? How many hectares can this plant? So, understanding the seed rate, one. Understand the region in which it's able to grow, two. And also understand how the same seed crop is stored after harvest. Others will find that they are very soft and are easily attacked by weevils. Okay, so you have the problems after harvest, okay, during your storage. And you may not even have the chance to go and buy aluminium phosphide, which is used as fumigant in medicine. Okay. Then we have different types of beans. I think we are going to rain also the pulses. This one is what? Soroes. This is Kablangeti.
It's
Kablangeti variety. Soroes variety. What is the variety? It's Kablangeti variety.
That's a common name.
This one is a mutant of Solwezi Ross. Okay? It's a mutant. And this was developed through induced mutation breeding after exposure to gamma rays at different kilohertz. And we came up with the mutants like this. So if you compare this one to the parent, this one looks different in terms of the size and also the motors which are on beans. And possibly also the chemical composition might be different. Okay? Though when you are doing mutations, like you are shooting in the air, you don't know what is likely to come out from there. Okay? But the whole idea is to create the genetic variation so that you have variation different from the parent and you are able to find something of your interest, whether maybe it becomes early or it becomes late or it changes the seed coat color or the size and life. Maybe to even be able to fix nitrogen much better than the parent. Okay?
Yeah. The one that you induced mutation.
This was the parent. Soroes loss.
Yes.
Okay. So we used the parent, we didn't use, this is a selection from that parent. The parent is very, very different. Okay. So it was taken to NISA and NISA blasted them, meaning they used the rays to pass through this. Okay? So that now you cause that genetic variation once you do what? You plant. Of course, in the first generation, on the first planting, you expect nothing like the variation in terms of the seed coat color, size, whether maturity, and it might not be different from the parent. But in the second generation, if you replant, you expect now the segregation to begin. Subsequent year, third year, you expect again the same mutant again to segregate. You find maybe the flowers which were white, they will start looking purplish. The leaves which were smaller, maybe they will look broader. Those which were broader, they will look narrower. In terms of color, of course, on the surface, maybe they will look shiny, very shiny. Okay? And also, in terms of the height, maybe it was bush type, it will become a climber. Okay? Those are what we are calling now. We are creating the variation. Now, you as a breeder, you have to find out what are you looking for. Okay? So, this is what we did some time back. Can I have the other seat? This one, we have people who are coming from Northern Province here. Do you know and Mongo guys? What is this? Wheat. This is wheat. This is upland rice.
The name is
written here. This is America, and we have different types of rice. So, not rice which you, it looks like this. And this one is coated with the, can somebody tell me the
painted.
Painted with what?
Paint.
With the paint. Yeah? It is painted, eh? It is seed dressed. Okay? To avoid the problems after harvesting. You can use the captain, you can use Terra and the blue cloth and
light. You mean to avoid after harvesting? What thing
the weevils attack the grain in storage. So the storage pests, like in maize, okay? In maize also we have those storage pests like Raja, grain borer, and like. That's why we do them. Of course, after it has attained a particular moisture content. Like in maize, usually they recommend 12%. Okay? Even this one is 12. So you see the similarities in some of these field crops. Okay? And the other issue why they like the recommendation of 12, it is easy to keep the seed at it will. Okay? And even when you are doing the fumigation and you use the aluminium phosphide, excuse me, if you use the aluminium phosphide, it doesn't require water. If there is water in your crop, you find the whole stack will be bent. Because aluminium phosphide will mix with water and you form the acid. All you see are the frames and you say, there was electric fault. Meanwhile, it's the injection, the fumigant which you use. Okay? Yeah. So, what next? You have soda? You didn't bring soda. Okay. Question which I have is, suppose you are given this one, we have NPK. Huh? 10, 10, 20, 10. Suppose here on K we had 0. Excuse me? Suppose here on K we had 0. And here 20. And there is 10. Then we want 10, 20, 10. And I provide potassium chloride. And I say, can you come up with compound D in the ratio of 1 to 2 to 1? Can you come up with that? How much potassium chloride we should add? Huh? You can calculate. Here we have 10, here we have 20, and here is 0. And I provide KPI. Huh? Exactly. That's why I want to assess whether you can do that or you have to redo that.
Can we
potassium?
Mungire.
So you are able to do that, eh? So go and revive. Here is 10. There is 2. I mean 20. There is 0. Which is 1, 2, 0.
Now she put a question. We have said this is the best way we are doing. Oh, 1, 2, 2.
Can you calculate?
Not today.
Not today, but you can go and revise.
Checking on the notes.
I'll need that. Otherwise, I'll consider it was done. Or I would want you to come up with something if I bring a question of that nature. So go and revise so that we can come and argue and contribute so that life becomes easier. Now, excuse me, before I forget.